Time is a curious commodity in art.
Originally, I was approached to think about what the gateway would be for UNMC.
On the one hand, the creative process takes time to conceive the work, define the problems, research, incubate, test, and produce the work.
So I started to draw the picture. There are lots of research going on behind of why I'm doing this and that.
But particularly when the work of art is a monumental public sculpture, the creative process requires dozens of artisans working hard to meet a deadline. Time speeds up. The assembly of the most visible elements of Jun Kaneko's Search Tower began with snow on the ground in late March. Kaneko surrounded his tower with concentric circles of black and tan bricks, thousands of them in alternating vertical and horizontal patterns. It took a lot of time to fit the bricks to the pattern, particularly in the tightest inner circle. Almost every rock-hard ceramic rectangle had to be cut into a trapezoid. On Wednesday, time seemed to speed up even more, as the sweeping curves made it easier to fit the bricks. At times it seemed like three workers became 10. The bricks are not just decorative, but functional. They will have to carry cars and trucks, including semi-trailers, around the traffic circle. A 6-inch concrete curb protects the inner circles and the tower, while concrete and asphalt underlies the bricks. Occasionally, the asphalt needed to be heated up and leveled off. Thursday broke cold and windy, but with the promise of sun. Asphalt adhesive was warmed up and applied as a base. Propane torches made the base layer pliable so bumps could be leveled out. As the bricks neared the outer edge, engineers realized that the last circle needed to be wider in order to fit the pattern. So, a wider circle was cut away and chiseled out. Then as the sun set, they ran out of bricks. Even the manhole and utility covers were part of the design, and that meant a lot more cutting and fitting on the last day of brick installation. What Jun Kaneko designed for the Buffett Cancer Center is an 82-foot tall, slim, gleaming tower. At first glance, it may look nothing like the lumpy clay sculptures known as dangos that Kaneko is famous for all over the world.
Usually, almost all ceramic artists start with wedging clay. But when you start wedging clay, it ends up round shape. One day I realized it's a pretty interesting shape, but it's so basic, I didn't have enough confidence to say, hey, this is good enough, just leave it alone.
As the dangos evolved, they got taller, and the glazes got more luminescent, qualities that are shared by the search tower.
If it's below my eye level, it's sort of still not threatening, but if I start passing my eye level and if it went like a 3-4 feet up, then your physical feeling to the shape really changes. the scale itself has definitely power of its own.
In the last week of April, the stained glass panels and the structures to hold them began arriving from Germany in 5 semi-trailers. The first trailer disgorged the stainless steel structure for the bottom section of the tower. Next came the second section with 3 layers, plus large crates with the glass panels. The third trailer held the third section and 2 more crates. Finally, the rest of the glass panels and the stacks of stainless steel frames were unloaded. As the afternoon ended, the first section was raised, rotated, and anchored in place. Tuesday, the German engineers realized that they needed to erect and position the top 2 sections as close to the final tower as possible. So they had to clear some space and move the tower sections to the corner of the parking lot. Each tower had to be rotated and leveled so that the interior ladders and, more importantly, the designs on the panels would line up correctly. Wednesday, the crew began attaching each glass panel to a supporting frame and then bolting the assembly into place on the superstructure. Each layer of the superstructure carries 12 glass panels that are bolted to a frame. Each of those panels is 7.5 feet high and weighs 100 kilograms or 220 pounds. Philip Schultz and Simon Edler used a template to position each frame behind the glass panels. A temporary winch mounted to the top of the section hoisted the panels into place. Torsten Zimmerman and Ronnie Ettinger had to choreograph acrobatic movements in a tight space so that each could reach the bolts on the top and bottom of the 7.5-foot panel. As the panels came into place, Kaneko's overall design emerged, bright swashes of primary colors overlaying a background of varying black and white lines. Kaneko says he was drawing the black and white patterns based on visual instinct alone, but when one of his patrons, Dr. James Linder, came to visit, he realized that the patterns were very close to the visual maps that cancer researchers use to represent the human genome and cancer mutations.
I didn't know anything about it. So he sent me a picture of it. Looks like it might work. And it came out so close, I couldn't believe it. I had a hard time to tell which one is which.
Thursday promised to be a long day as the engineers from Derrick's Glass Studios in Western Germany tried to take advantage of good weather to get most of the glass panels attached to the upper structures. Each panel started with safety glass as the carrier on the outside. Kaneko's designs were then hand-blown or cut from antique stained glass. The design elements were then laminated to the carrier glass. The panels are durable, but they were packed carefully for their trip across the Atlantic. Later, rows of LED lights were mounted inside to illuminate the sculpture at night. For Kaneko, there is little difference between the glass and the glazes that he applies to his pottery projects. In fact, they are chemically the same. But glass can be lit from within, and that adds a new dimension to the search tower. As shadows lengthened, the upper towers took on their final forms. Monday dawned cloudy and cold as work moved to the four sections of the base tower. The boxes with the panels had been moved onto the brick circles, and the workers ignored the med center traffic that flowed around them. By mid-afternoon, the temperatures were rising, and they worked well past sunset. The goal Tuesday was to finish hanging the panels on the base tower. Anchor the panels to the frames, raise, and repeat. Altogether, there are 1,800 square feet of glass weighing 24,438 pounds in the search tower. The tower is 24 feet in circumference, and the superstructure is made up of 16,482 pounds of steel. As the last panels of the base went into place, the majesty of Kaneko's vision became apparent. After 6 days of tweaking the installation, it was time to stack the towers together. We'll be right back.
I'm really proud to have this piece in my hometown in Omaha. And then thank you for giving me opportunity. And I know so many people got involved with this project.
On June 14th, patrons, officials of the University of Nebraska Medical Center, and art lovers gathered to dedicate and light the search tower, even though the midsummer sun lingered late into the evening.
I've been thinking about what should I say tonight. I didn't come up anything to say. Because I guess I'm more like making things, but not talk about what I did. Since I'm not that good at it, maybe Susan could help me. She has been helping me over 20 years about these issues.
The most difficult part of this tower is that it is meant to be viewed both front and backlit, and most glass has extremely different behaviors in these contrasting light conditions. It is great for Jun to work with a master glass artisan, Karl-Heinz Trout, who traveled here from Germany for the dedication, from Diewick's Glass Studios, for his amazing ability to translate Jun's designs into a perfect balance of color and brilliance. The project was so extensive that Diewick's Glass Studios rented an additional facility in Tannenstein, near Wiesbaden, Germany, and they called it the Omaha Studio. And six artisans worked there full-time with Carl, cutting and assembling the art glass from June of 2016 through January of 2017, using 380 sheets of hand-blown glass selected from many more sheets for their exact shading and tone and color. On a more poetic note, one of June's lifelong goals as an artist is to become as close to the material as possible, until he can almost become one with it. But how can you become one with your medium across the ocean? With Carl's amazing artistic ability, June was able to reach his aesthetic hand across the ocean with Carl's hand and guide the project forward perfectly.